and give control back to me. Just stop your hangout sharing. So I will share my screen. Yeah, right. Can you see my screen now? Yeah, so let's start the journey. MVC 5 advanced web application. Okay, so today we will just this whole course will be around 18 to 20 hours. Moreover, I would not like to deal with in hours, because I want you to earn the knowledge I'm having about MVC. So we will try to touch to all the basics of the MVC first, then we will go with the practicals of MVC. So, and then I will give you few little homeworks also. Meanwhile, you can try yourself with those. Okay. Yeah. So the first part is what is MVC? Okay. So practically thinking, MVC is just a model view controller. Okay. Everybody says that. Okay, so I will using these methods, I would like to tell what exactly the MVC is. Okay, so here you are. Okay, the control is the main thing who controls model and the view, means passing the data from view to model and doing after some manipulations or adding some business logic here and passing those results back to view. So this is a simple definition you can say about MVC. Okay. So the first part, what is MVC? So we will go with the actual page life cycle of MVC. Can you see? Yeah, here you are. Whenever a request from browser comes, it hits to IIS, right? Then it will check whether what is the URL, means whether the page is ASPX or HTML or some other extension. It will use HTTP handlers to detect what kind of request is coming from URL, right? It will go to IIS, then IIS will go to routing. In MVC, there is a routing table. Routing table means it stores the routes of the pages. Means suppose you have your register page, okay? So register page, entering what URL you will reach to register page, it stores that in a routing table. So very first important mechanism of MVC is routing. So it detects whether this route is present or not, whether we can serve this request or not. If route is not present, means if you add invalid URL in a browser, it will redirect you to no page found. Okay. So this is the routing module, very important module, the very first step of any MVC page lifecycle. Then it goes to controller. As I told you, in controller who handles everything, means between view and model, it makes communication possible between model and view. Okay, so here it detects which controller, means whenever you hit if you remember last time we created our application, this MVC demo, I will open it once and we'll show you the URL. So it is taking some time. We have also created a database of MVC demo where these all tables got created automatically when we registered first user, right? If you remember. Okay, this is the MVC demo we created last time. I will run it. And one more thing, you have your account on GitLab or not? If you need to register, I will push all the codings we are doing throughout the training. We'll push here and we'll share those coding with you so that it will help you in future to refer those codes. Okay. Yeah. I will. This is my GitLab profile, and you can register here on GitLab. Slowly and steadily, we will go through practicals, because on the very first day, I don't want you to do practical steps. Just I want you to understand what exactly MVC and the flow of MVC. Okay. Yeah. So today we will have only 1 hour of session. So that will not be irritate you too much. So I have run that code we just created last time. Okay, so it's running. It's taking some time. This is my Git repo as well. Git is not that much secure nowadays. GitLab, you can privately share your code with others, and lots of stuffs are there. So I prefer to use GitLab over GitHub, but I also actively work on GitHub also. Yeah, this is nice. I will restart it again. It is taking some time. Let's see. Very first time it takes some time. So let's discuss this one. Whenever you want access particular MVC page, the URL pattern is like controller/action. Okay. Means home controller and index action. Okay. Or account controller and register. So here you can see I want to register. I want to access login page. I will click on login. So if you can observe here, this is controller name and this is action name. If we go in code here in Solution Explorer, go in controllers, here we have account controller. Can you see? Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's fine. So here is login action. This is called as action. If you can see here, it is returning action result. So this is an action. Okay. So controller/action. I will access this again. You will see our breakpoint is hit. Yeah. So and here is a hierarchy. Views, under that views there is the folder called as account. Whatever the name is there for controller, there is a one folder for that controller. And here you can see login page. Okay. .cshtml is basically a reserved page. It is indicating login.cshtml is the page is designed and coded in Razor syntax. We will come to Razor syntax as well as we will proceed. Okay. So this is so now we will I have added a breakpoint here. So whenever you hit in the browser account/login, it will come first here in control. And then it will, we will debug it and return view. You can see now it is returning view. We have not passed anything here. So it will by default will find login view in accounts folder. And if you can see now it is going here. This is view start.cshtml is like a master page. In our traditional SPX we do, there we have master pages, right? Right. this layout.css.html is a master page. I will add few comments after stopping debugging so that you will find it easy. Now you can see we are in login.css.html. Okay, so here you can see viewback.title is login, means here at the top you can see here login. This is a title of this page. Okay. This view is accepting model of type login view model. If we go here, you will find model, just what we can say a blueprint of a login page. We want to means we want to have username, password, and some checkbox around that button here. Remember me. This is username. This is password. Remember me. A checkbox and the login button. So this view is accepting this kind of model, right? This is so you understood. We want to access login page, we need to add controller/page, right? So we are here now, right? Controller, account controller, we are in controller. So then it proceeded to here, action invoker. Action was invoked, right? Debugger was there on this login, right? So action was invoked. Then it will bind models. So in the gate, there are two types of methods we can have in a controller with the same name. If you can see login, and this is also login, but there is a difference. This is a post method. Okay. And if you don't HTTP get, it will automatically, by default, it is a get method. Okay. HTTP post, and this is HTTP get. There are comments added, so you will find it easy to understand. Okay, login, get method, and the post method, and this is returning action result. So we are here in MVC page lifecycle. Authenticate the user, whether this user is allowed, is authenticated or not. Okay, if you want to authenticate user first, then it will force you to go to login page or some other page, whichever page you specify. In authentication, it will first do authentication of the user, then authorization. Authorization means whether Ketan is allowed to access this page or not, whether he's having right to access. Means we have different roles at application level, right? Super admin, admin, normal user, some other different roles we have. So it will execute that filter, or means whether he is allowed to access this page or not. Then it will go to action filters, means it will then start executing this action. It is the view wants action result, right? So it will execute anything is there coded or something like some database calls or some other stuff. It will start executing those actions. Okay, this part, action execution, and then it will create a action result. Okay, if you can see here, it will return a action result of this action. So now it's view's responsibility to render whatever returned by that action. So view, it is controller will just only return action result. It's the responsibility of view to understand and render that result passed by controller. Here you can see result filters. So it will identify the result, what kind of result it is, whether it is a JSON, whether it is HTML, some other type of we will come to what are the different types of return types we can return from here. Okay, so this is a overview of a ASP.NET page lifecycle. First routing, controller, action execution, and result execution. You can render this as a rakar. Rakar means routing, controller, action execution, and result parsing. So Rucker is not having any meaning, but to keep in mind whenever the interviewer asks you, tell me page lifecycle of MVC, it is quite easy to remember everything. Rucker means routing, okay. Controller, action, execution, and result parsing or execution. Got it? So just to remember, I will ping it here. Okay. So this is a basic overview of basic ASP.NET MVC page lifecycle: routing, controller, action, and result. And in action, while telling action, you have to mention these two things: authentication and authorization. And the sequence you should be follow the sequence also: authentication first and then authorization. You cannot authorize that user before authentication. You have to first authenticate that user and then authorize it. Okay. So are you clear with this? Yeah, I will share all these images with you so that it will be easy for you to understand. So it's. There are a few other architectures also around model view and controller. MVVM pattern, MVC pattern, MVVM pattern. So in you will understand MVC, I will come to MVVM pattern also, but at this moment I don't want you to confuse between MVVM and MVC. So let's proceed. So this is the routing mechanism I just talked about, routing system. It will parse URL in the format of controller and action. We will find match table of MVC. Okay, so it will whether the route found, yes, then process request X, throw HTTP 404 error, means page not found error. So in this fashion it works. This is also a simple representation where you want to access account/index to ASP.NET, get login page. Now we will see post method works. Okay, so now last time I have saved my username and password. I will hit login. You just see the breakpoint is there in the model. If you can see, you can yes. I will come to that also. I will show it is a configured in view part. I will show you how we implement that. Okay, so we posted our form. So this is coming in HTTP post method. So you can see we got a model where password, you can see username, and the remember me is false because we have not checked it, so it is false. Return URL means return when return URL comes, means you directly want to access this page from somewhere else and you are not authenticated, then return URL where to return after successful login. It is mentioned in this return URL. So now we have access directly login page, so there is a no return URL query parameter. Okay, so we are here. So I will debug it once. It will check model state is valid or not. Is valid? Yeah, it is valid because we have entered password and username. If we have no, if the username will be blank, if would have been gone to this line, this is true, so it is going inside. user manager find a sync. This is a method provided by security model of ASP.NET MVC. This is an inbuilt model. You don't need to write anything. You just need to pass username and password. So it is going and retrieving the whether this user is present in our database or not. So yeah, you got it. So you can see user is not null. So we got something from there. So next line, user is not null. So sign in asynchronously this user and just return to local URL. So it is returning. So you can see we are logged into system successfully. I will log off once and I will show you how it will go to that post method on the coding side. Okay, so I will minimize this one. So here I just told you this login view model, which is just a footprint what exactly the controls we want on a page. So login, so it is coming there. I'm continuing. First time get, we got it right. So I will inspect it. You will see this input method here, where name attribute of this input class is username. So whenever you hit login, first thing here you see form. This is form tag. Okay, here action attribute you can see. Method post. These two things you just need to observe at this moment only. Account/login and method post. Whenever and let's observe this button. You asked me a good question. After hitting login, it is now going to post. Why? So here you see type submit. Whenever the input type with the type submit, it posts the form or it renders the form tag. Just subsequent form tag of that button, it will use retrieve this action attribute value and will execute the post method of this method post. So if you can see how we generate form tag in MVC with this HTML begin form, this is the controller. If you this rub it once and just share. Yeah, can you see now different constructor it is showing, what kind of different parameters you can have for HTML. So we are using this one where we are passing action name, controller name and some form method. Here we have two options to get. Now let's say I will set it to get. Okay, and I will refresh it once by clicking login. I will remove this. I will keep it because now we have marked it as a get. Oh, I think it is refreshing. Yeah, so it is refreshed now. Now you can see method is get. So now I will hit this login button because its type is submit. It will do whatever mentioned in method attribute of the form tag. We have asked it to go to get action of this account/login. So let's see where it goes. Can you see? Now it is going to get. So whenever we want to post data to database, we generally use post to method, form method as a post. Okay. You also observed one thing. We got directly model here, right? So we got username, we got password, we got whether it is here, right? Yeah. Whenever you are putting something in URL in browser, we are using HTTP GET request. So whenever you put any URL in any browser, it will execute HTTP GET method. So by default, our HTTP GET method is present here. If we comment out this one, it will show page not found. Every time it will happen with any request, HTTP GET. So that's why it gone to GET. So now the question comes in mind, how this magic is happening? So username, password automatically getting captured here, right? You must be curious to know about this. So the very basic fund about it, first we created a form, right? This form. Then we have this control with the name, username, right? So again, we have another control with password, with whose name is password, right? So now let's say I will not enter this username and I will try to log in this. Now, as soon as I click login, it is showing me username field is required. How it comes? Okay, here you see this data val required attribute. There the message is username field is required. So where it is declared? So let's go to this login view model. Whatever is there, so here's you see we have marked it as a required. I want this username to be displayed as a username dash name. Can you see here? Space. So in Sisha we need to declare a variable with no space, and when we want to see it, there should be space between user and name. So display, this is called as a data annotation. We will come to this one also, but just overview of the required and the how exactly this model mechanism works. So you can see I want to display this part of model as a username dash space name, and I want user to enter username. Without username, he is not allowed to enter into the system. So it is whenever you click this, now the method is get, so it is not going there. So I need to change that part. It is called as a data annotation. Data annotation. It is in the same way, but on model level. Here is the namespace system.component.model.data_annotation. It is provided by Microsoft data annotation. They you just need to add this required attribute over the field you want user, you want to force user to enter. Okay, so we want user to enter this. I'm just refreshing once because we here method is get, the previous page it is there. So let's refresh it once so that it will, we will have post method in place. So you can, now we have post. So this is required. Now let's try to play around it. Here you can observe one thing also, data type dot password. Yeah, so here you cannot see my password, but the code, in code you can see, but on screen you are not able to see my password. Okay, so to achieve this, we need to add this attribute data type over that member of a class. This is just like a class, you can see class. It is called as model, but it is a class only. Okay, so because of this name attribute to each control, okay, name attribute, username, the password, this name attribute of a control, MVC in the auto mapping of the fields with model. Okay, So here our post action wants the model of type login view model, okay, and it knows what are the fields in view model. So it will start scanning whole form. As you remember, here we have username as a member here, username. So it will scan the form tag with the name attribute username. So he got a control and he will pick that value inserted in that control, and we'll do we'll assign it to that model. Okay, so this is inbuilt mechanism called as auto mapping, auto model mapping in MVC. Model mapping, or you can say model binding as well. Okay, so now you got fair idea about this. What is MVC? How it works? Why MVC? I would like to explain now, and its benefits. Okay. So you remember we created last time a empty application with the type MVC, where we got these two projects. Okay. This is a web application and this is a sample test project. Okay, I will stop this once and I will the test explorer I will open. Here it is, test explorer, test window, test explorer. I want to see test explorer and I will build it once. It will start scanning whatever, how many test cases are there in project. You see here green, so he identified 3 test cases implemented in our project here. So what exactly test cases, I will just tell you. Run all, I'm running all the test cases written. It will show me, yeah, everything is passed. It is just like a hard coded, it will hit to database or some other stuff and will check whether the result is null or not. Some other different options are there. This is nowadays a very popular thing developers do. They want their code to be testable. So everything is test driven. TDD means test driven app development, where we first write the test cases and we will break our code and we'll write code and we'll make things working. So here we have lots of options: are equal, not same, failed, or is false, or true, not null, something like that. We can add all those. If we say null, it's null. So our test case will fail, right? So previously it was checking is null. So you see failed test. So you can directly go to here, we'll debug it from here, debug what exactly going wrong in that sense. And why MVC? I would like to give that answer in detail. Here you have separation of concerns. You have controller, models and views in place. Okay. Here you have test projects. Okay, so the developer's life is quite easy now. If you see, you just need to create one model. You just have seen that we are posting our form and it is posting all the model with the values to us in controller here. That is quite easy. It means for a developer it is quite easy now to test their each and every line of code here. So on higher view, I will tell why MVC is like there are separation of concerns and these test projects where we have API, web API. Okay, why what is web API? So if you would have I think you worked on WCF or not? Yeah, in WCF you WCF basically deals with SOAP messaging, where you have XML driven data transfer. Okay, but now I want there are few different new conventions in market, like JSON data you can return, HTML page you can directly return from any method. So WSAP only deals with XML. So that Web API gives that flexibility to return different type of data. Okay, so that and Web API is basically built on top of MVC only. So underlying platform or underlying structure of Web API is MVC only. Okay, so today we will discuss the project structure, the importance of the folders created by default. Okay, so the very first thing here, references. You must be aware of these references. We add different DLL references here. Okay, so I will start from here. Web config. You must be aware of this web config also. Why web config is there and all. Okay. So global.sx. So whenever application gets start, it will start from here. If we run from here, it will first hit here. Okay, global.sx application start event, right? Here we are. Can you see? Yeah. So all the application level required settings we will do in application start. Okay. So we will go line by line how it is registering web APIs, area registration, what exactly area is, filters, and you will gradually and steadily you will understand these all four lines. Okay, so I will stop this. So first I will mark it as a to-do for future. Okay, so it will not create confusion for you. So today we will check this configure. I'm pressing F12. This global configurations means global level configuration of a web application will be handled by this configure method, where we are passing web API config dot register method. Here in app start, if you press F12, you are redirected to here. So this is a static class where you have a static method and it is accepting configs, different configs. Here you see the routes I just talk about, this routes. So I told you the very first step is routing. So if you see in global.sx, the very first step is to find a route or register route. Okay, so everything is managed by this web API config. It will accept, yeah, the route config. Yeah, this is a web API config, but where you have ability to register routes. You see here, routes, map route. So by default, you want all requests to get routed through this pattern, API slash controller and with some ID, or and here you see ID is a optional, where if you not entering ID, it will also redirect to that page. Here are different parameters you can add here, like name and all, like here, just like name with some value to this, and you just need to add here like this. Means you want all the requests to route in this fashion only. All your application requests you want to route in this fashion only. So for this purpose you can add routes here. So here is a web API config registration. Means whatever the API hits will come, will first match it with the routes. Okay, So this is global.sx. It's always good to have error event also in place. I will add this error. Right. Absolutely, exactly. So var ex server dot get server dot get last error. Whenever any error comes in your application, it should be get logged so that you can trace it, right? So this is the application level event. Whenever any error comes in our application, it will be captured in EX and we will log it to database. We will create some table and we'll log it to database. So for this purpose, you can use it. So this is the way global.sx I just talked about. We will come to this part just now. Okay, so view is very important in this MVC. So whatever is there is only because of view. Shared, you see here, shared folder. Shared is basically to store all the common pages, means like master pages is we use commonly, right? So we are storing, this is our master page layout.cshtml. okay, you see here viewback.title was declared in this login page. Okay, if you see the here, we are setting viewback.title. Okay, and it is accessed here, and just next to it we have added a constant string. And if you observe here, I think it is stopped, so just need to run it once, so you will observe how these things are working. The MVC basics are very important. We will go very slowly and steadily. Once you understand this, the rest of the things down are not that much easy, difficult. You just need to six first. So we will go slowly and steadily. Okay. Yeah, we will. Fine. We will check it. We will check. So. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah, I understand. I will create that from scratch. Don't worry about that. Just I want you to understand the concept of MVC first, so that it will be quite easy for you to understand the next things. Okay, now this is I told you this layout.cshtml is a master page, right? So in the top corner you can see my ASP.NET title, my ASP.NET application. So we have a hard coded this. You can add here like MVC demo. I will save it and will refresh, and you will see the changes. And throughout all the pages, you will see MVC demo. Okay, we will go to register. Now also there is MVC demo. If you change something here, it will reflect everywhere throughout the application. So all the application level things we will do in master page, right? Here only in layout.cshtml. Whatever the application level CSS which all the pages will use, we will add those CSS and JS. It's always good to have all your scripts at the bottom of your page. Okay, so whenever user hits your page, he will see first the page and then scripts will load asynchronously. There is also one good practice to have async in script tag. Okay, just try to You see this attribute. Just remove this. Whenever you write this attribute to script tag async, this script will be loaded asynchronously in the background. So user will see the page, and in background scripts will be loaded. Okay, for this purpose we, in day-to-day life, we use this async. In your applications you can also try this one. Okay, so this is the master page I just told you. Here you see now this is a Bootstrap thing. We will come to Bootstrap thing afterward. Okay, here Bootstrap things we will cover later in session. Okay, so these all are the Bootstrap classes. Now only you can just think of the classes are declared container and all. Okay, here you see application name. Okay, I will change it to okay. I will refresh it and you will see MVC demo has appeared. So this is internally creating an anchor tag. Okay, we will inspect it after writing this line of code. Directly we got an anchor tag. Can you see? Yeah, and the text is MVC. Function F12, and this is a cursor. You can inspect each and everything by this mouse. You can check the width and height and all. Okay, so this is the upper part, these two things you see here, the action links. So when you want to access a particular page in MVC, you need to mention action and controller, right? Action and controller. So I will show you this link home. I want to access home. Let's access about home, controller and about action. Okay, yes. So how we have written that one? I want HTML action link, means I want anchor tag whose text will be about, and after clicking on anchor tag I want user to get redirected to about action of home controller. Yeah, can you recollect? Yeah, so these are the three navigation we want to have on our page. Okay, so we have added that here. So we have the next part is the partial view. Partial view, this is very 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 nice and important concept of partial view. How much more time you have, Supriya, with you now? Okay, fine, we will stop after 5-10 minutes. So that, okay, partial view. What is partial view? Partial view, you see here, login partial is the name of partial, which is present in the shared part as we are accessing it on master page, layout page. Let's call master page as a layout page. In MVC term we call it as a layout page. So let's practice it as a layout. So you just got that idea, na? That layout is masters. So I will start calling master as a layout page from now onwards. So that, so here is a partial view, login partial, which is stored in shared folder. Okay, so we want to have this section register and login page on all pages, right? So we are putting those two links in these are the two links. I will come to this part later. We will come to this gradually and steadily. We want to have two links at the top with register and login as a text and navigation to register and login page respectively. So we have added that part in a single CSHTML in a login page, and we are calling it here. Okay. So this is the concept of partial view. This is just overview. We will go in. We will deep dive into this partial view concept. This is a very important concept you must be aware of. So here is in partial view. The partial view you can. Right. But to access partial view, you should have first page. So you are calling partial view inside a page, means you are calling a page inside a page. Okay, can you recollect? I will tell you. This part is a part of the page, right? Register and login. Okay. So layout is a master part, right? But register and login is a part of that master. Okay, so right. So this is if you want to call this again on our account page, in login page, let's say I want to call it anywhere. Okay, so I will put that line here and we'll use it. So when you want to create some control of your custom control like grid and all, you will write it once only and will reuse it everywhere. So right, user control. Debugger is there, so that's why it is getting stopped. You can see. Yeah, I understand. This is right. I used to work with that SPX and waveform also. I also did the same things you are doing. This is right way to understand these things. You see here, register and login two links are coming directly. So by just calling that on login page here, right? So in this way, you can create your own custom part of the page you want to repeat it throughout the application. So like footer, so we have a constant view footer in application. We have constant menu, we have constant footer throughout the application, so we will have those things in place. So we will here in layout we have this footer here, right? We will move it to one partial view and we'll call it. So as simple as that. If you want to change anything related to footer, you will just go into that single page and it will be replicated throughout the application. So you no need to change each and every page. So if you want to change the links of your menu, you will change in only one partial view. Okay, so this is use of partial reusability, you can say. So you got this idea about the master page. Okay, so here now you can see content.cs and the bundle.modernizer. What is modernizer? First I will explain. Modernizer is a JS. Now we have different browsers. We want to have our old browsers, means old application, means our application should be accessible on all browsers, right? Whether it is old or new. So to make them compatible with all the browsers, we use this modernizer.js. If you see, here is the JS. It is worldwidely used by all the web applications. Modernizer.js. This is a JavaScript written library. We just refer it on our page. Right. So just like a content placeholder in our SPX, we have written this render body here. So whatever the pages of our application will be replaced here in render body, just like a content placeholder in our traditional ASPX. Okay, so for this purpose we are adding this render page. So one last concept I would like to tell of bundling. What exactly the bundling is? Here you see bundle.config. Okay, so here let's observe this bundle CSS, content.css, and which is called here. Can you see? Yeah. Whatever the CSS you want to club, means 5-10 application level CSS, you will club them here. Okay, with this name. We will align these all CSS with this name and we'll call like this. So what is purpose of this? The main basic purpose, developer will say, the grouping of the things and aliasing all the scripts, and which will save my lines of codes. But the important thing which many developers don't know is where any web browser in throughout the world will, whenever you hit HTTP GET method, it will hit 7 requests at a time. The count may differ to 7 to 10 with different browser, but at a time, if you have 10 CSS on a page, okay, so only 7 will be hit. 7 will be hit to get HTTP GET method. Means you will get 7 files at a time. In the next loop, it will retrieve remaining 3. So in bundling, what happens, you are grouping all the CSS together, so it will be considered as a one request only. For this purpose, bundle is used, and the whatever the bundles you want to use throughout the application is defined in bundle.config here, which is placed in app start folder. And bundle.config is initialized at application level in global.sx method. If you see here, bundle.config register all the bundles, register all these bundles whenever application gets start. Okay, so today, just to summarize what we covered: what is MVC, why MVC, how MVC works. Okay, this solution architecture part is still remaining in progress. Okay, so MVC page life cycle, in the very beginning we had gone through, right, that image, this image, and the Razor view engine and SPX view engine, means Razor view and SPX view, how we correlate render body with the content placeholder, different correlation. Yeah. So we covered this first thing where this solution architecture part is remaining little bit. We have understood these URL patterns, so still these three things are remaining. So we have covered almost 4 to 5 topics today. Okay, so this is a very first session, so I want you to understand things in detail. Okay, let me go. Okay, in global SX. Yeah, we will talk that. That's why only I marked that second MVC solution architecture in progress. I have marked it as a in progress. So we will. Because it will be a heavy dose for you to understand all 4 lines in on a very first day. Okay, so are we good today? Yeah. Okay, so let's stop. Have a nice day. Yeah, bye.